Well, students, in this lecture, we are going to derive an expression for what is called as the acceptance angle, Imax, of an optical fiber. Okay, so this is an important derivation in this chapter, acceptance angle. Now, first, before we derive the formula for it, acceptance angle, let us try to understand what is this acceptance angle all about, Imax. Okay, so we have here an optical fiber. This is the starting end of the optical fiber. Light is incident from this end, it enters the core. Now, this region here, the white color region, what you see is the core having a refractive index mu 1. Surrounding the core is the cladding having refractive index mu 2. Outside the cladding should have actually been the sheath, which is not shown in this diagram because it doesn't play any role in the working of the fiber. And then right outside the fiber is the surrounding. It could be air, mostly it is air, but it could be some other medium also. That's why we have said that the surrounding medium has a refractive index mu naught. So now, core is the densest. So mu 1 is greater than mu 2. Cladding is rarer compared to the core. So mu 1 is greater than mu 2. And then surrounding, which is normally air, is the least densest. So we can write that mu 1 is greater than mu 2, is greater than mu naught. So cladding has a refractive index greater than that of the surroundings, which is normally the case. Now, the ray of light is, as I told you, always made to enter the core of the fiber. So this is the incident ray falling on one end of the optical fiber. It is incident at the point A. Now this dotted line which you see here is the axis of the fiber. And at this point here, this dotted line is also the normal to the surface, the starting end of the fiber at point A. So this is the normal. So that's why this angle here is I, the angle of incidence. Angle made by the incident ray with the normal to the surface of the optical fiber. Now, so since the fiber is going from surrounding to air, might be this is surrounding to core. So surrounding, let us say, is air, and this is, let us say, glass. So it's going from rarer to denser. So the ray at point A bends towards the normal. It's going from rarer to denser. So it bends towards the normal, making an angle of refraction R. Okay, at this point. Then it travels in a straight line till it meets the core cladding boundary. So at this point B, it is hitting the core cladding boundary. Now, this dotted line which you see here is the normal drawn to the core cladding boundary. So this angle theta is the angle of incidence made by this ray with the core cladding boundary. So this is the normal, and the angle made by this ray with the normal is the angle of incidence theta. Now, for total internal reflection to take place, we require this theta to be greater than the critical angle, okay, IC. So for total internal reflection to take place at point B, it is required that this angle theta should be greater than the critical angle. Only then the ray will undergo TIR. If not, what will happen? If theta is not greater than IC, if theta is less than IC, then the ray will go out, will go through the cladding and be lost from the fiber. It will not continue forward. It will not propagate through the fiber. So it is absolutely required, the second condition of TR absolutely requires that this angle theta should be greater than the critical angle IC. So this is the important part in this derivation. Okay, the requirement that theta should be greater than the critical angle IC. Now, what happens here is that this is the ray falling. So as I increase this I, so suppose I bend this ray more this way. If I bend this ray more this way, so in other words, if I increase this angle of incidence I at which the light is falling on one end of the fiber, so if I is increased, what will happen to R? R will also increase. Why? Because as I bend this ray more this ray will bend more this way upwards. So R also will increase. But remember, as R increases, this angle theta, what will happen to it? It will decrease. Why? Because this angle here is 90 degrees. If this angle is 90, then this plus this, R plus theta, must be also 90. It's a constant. So the sum of R and theta is 90 degrees, which is a constant because this is 90. Okay. Now, if as we increase I, R also increases, theta naturally has to decrease because R plus theta must remain a constant, which is 90. Okay. So as R increases, theta decreases. Now, can we decrease theta to any value? Can we keep on decreasing theta and still expect the light to undergo TIR? No, there is a limit, right? What is the limit? Theta cannot be decreased below what? Theta cannot be decreased below the critical angle. If theta is decreased below the critical angle, then the light will not undergo TIR. Okay. So now, as we increase I, R decreases, but theta R, sorry, as we increase I, R also increases, but theta decreases. So as we keep on increasing I, theta will keep on decreasing, but there is a limit on theta. So there is a maximum limit up to which can increase I. If you try to increase I beyond a certain limit, then theta will decrease below the critical angle and the ray will not undergo TIR. So the maximum angle up to which we can increase this I here and still expect the ray to undergo TIR, that maximum angle here is called as the acceptance angle of the fiber. So if the light falls on the fiber at an angle greater than critical angle, what will happen? This theta will decrease below the critical angle and the ray will not undergo TIR, but it will be lost from the sides and come out of the fiber. So it is always required that this angle I should be such that its maximum value can be equal to I max. That's what is called as I max, maximum angle of incidence. So maximum angle of incidence is called as the acceptance angle of the fiber. So I hope you have understood about this concept of acceptance angle. So once again, what is acceptance angle? It is the maximum angle of incidence up to which the ray will undergo total internal reflection and propagate through the fiber. If we increase I beyond I max, the theta value will decrease below critical angle and the ray will not undergo TIR, but it will lost from the sides. So we are deriving a formula for this maximum angle of incidence, which is also called as the acceptance angle. Okay, so in the limiting case, what we will be having when I is equal to I max, in the limiting case, we can say when I becomes its maximum attainable value, which is I max, theta will become its minimum attainable value. What is the minimum value theta can take? It is IC. So that's the limiting condition. So when I is equal to I max, so when I attains its maximum value, theta attains its minimum value, which is IC. If you try to increase I beyond I max, theta will become less than IC and the ray will not undergo TIR. So this is the important equation, limiting condition it is called. Okay, a limiting case. I is equal to I max, when I becomes equal to I max, theta becomes equal to IC. So this is the equation which we'll be using in the derivation main part. Now, what we're going to do now starting is we're going to apply Snell's law to this refraction. Now, this is the incident ray, this is the refracted ray, this is normal refraction. Light is going from rarer medium to denser medium, so it undergoes normal refraction at point A. So we're going to apply Snell's law at point A. So what is Snell's law? Snell's law says that sin I upon sin R is equal to sin I upon sin R is equal to refractive index. If you remember, I told you it's the refractive index of second medium upon first medium. So light is going from this medium to this medium. So this is first medium, this is second medium. So sin I upon sin R is refractive index of second medium. Second medium here is the core and the first medium here is the surrounding, which is mu naught. Okay. So sin I upon sin R is core upon surrounding. So mu 1 upon mu naught. Okay, so this is again equation. Now, in this triangle ABC, this is a right angle triangle. We know that this angle here is 90 degrees. So therefore, R plus theta is also 90 degrees. Okay, so in triangle ABC, R plus theta is 90 degrees. So which implies that R is 90 minus theta. So therefore, taking sine on both sides, sine R will be equal to sine of 90 minus theta. But sine of 90 minus theta is cos theta. So we have sine R is equal to cos theta. So what we get is, what we'll do is, we have here sin r is equal to cos theta. So in this equation 2, we'll replace sin r with cos theta. So we get sin I upon cos theta is equal to sin I upon cos theta is equal to mu 1 upon mu naught. Okay, so we have replaced this sin r over here with cos theta as per this equation 3. So what we are interested in, so what we have here is sin I. Sin I will, so cos theta is taken other side. So sin I is mu 1 upon mu naught into cos theta, equation 4. Now, what we'll do is, we'll use the limiting condition, this equation 1, I is equal to Imx, theta equal to Ic, in this equation 4, okay? So, we'll replace I with Imax and theta with Ic in this equation. So, what we get here? Sin Imax becomes mu 1 upon mu naught into cos of Ic. Now, what is the aim of the thing? Our aim is to determine Imax. So, somehow we want to write a formula for acceptance angle Imax. But before that, what we'll do is, we'll substitute for Ic. Now, what we know is, if you remember in the previous, in the discussion of total internal reflection, we had derived the formula for critical angle. We had derived this as sine IC as mu 2 upon mu 1. So what we have, cos IC therefore will be what? Root of 1 minus sine square IC. This is, we know sine square theta plus cos square theta is equal to 1. So cos theta will be root of 1 minus sine square theta. So cos IC will be root of 1 minus sine square IC. But sine IC we know from the formula for critical angle, sine IC is mu 2 upon mu 1. So we put it over here and on simplification we get cos IC is equal to root of mu 1 square minus mu 2 square upon mu 1. Okay, you can simplify this and see, you will get this answer. Now, what we'll do is we'll substitute the value of cos IC as this value into this place over here. Okay, so what we'll get therefore is sin IMAX is equal to mu 1 upon mu naught into cos of IC, but cos of IC is this part here. Okay, so we get it as √(mu1)² - √(mu2)² / √(mu1). Now mu1 will cancel out, and therefore we'll get sin IMAX is equal to √(mu1)² - √(mu2)² / √(mu0). This mu naught remains there. So and therefore IMAX therefore will be how much? Sine inverse. If IMAX, sin IMAX is this thing, so sin IMAX will be sin inverse of this quantity. So this is the formula for your acceptance angle. So this is a very simple derivation. The index derivation, the main thing what we have used is we have used Snell's law, and also then we have used the limiting condition that I is equal to the acceptance angle IMAX. When I is equal to the acceptance angle IMAX, the theta is equal to the critical angle IC of the fiber. Okay, so based on this thing, we have derived the formula for the acceptance angle IMAX. Okay, so this is the formula for IMAX. Now, if you see in this formula, there are three things coming there, mu1, mu2 and mu0. So, mu1 we know is the refractive index of the core, mu2 is the refractive index of the cladding, and mu0 is the refractive index of the surrounding. Now, if the surrounding medium is air, which is normally the case, then mu0 value will be equal to 1. If it is not air, then whatever is the surrounding medium, its refractive index will have to be put there. Okay, so this is the formula, important formula. Many problems also come based on this formula for the acceptance angle of the optical fiber. So we have done an important derivation in this chapter here. Thank you.